First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Stratios Batselis for accepting the invitation to give a lecture at our Research Institute Center of Operation Research of the Miguel Hernández University of Elche. It is a pleasure and an honor for me to introduce him for several reasons. Firstly, because he's a first-rate researcher on the subject he's going to talk about. And secondly, because for a few months, Dr. Batselis has been collaborating with our research group in photovoltaic modeling, formed by José Manuel Blanes, Vicente Galeano, María Victoria Herranz, and myself. And we have already obtained some results that seem promising. Now, let me say a few but interesting things about his academic and research career. Dr. Stratios Batselis is an Engineering for Development Research Fellow of the Royal Academy of Engineering, and he has been a lecturer within electronics and computer science at the University of Southampton since April 2021. So let me congratulate him for this new position. Prior to this post, he was a research fellow at Imperial College London since November 2019. And before that, he held an European Marie Curie individual fellowship on photovoltaic control and integration from November 2017. He obtained his PhD degree from the National Technical University of Athens, RIS, in 2016. Dr. Batselis is an experienced researcher with many IEcube publications and a funding grant track record of more than £1.6 million. He's a senior IEcube member, a fellow of the Higher Education Academy, and an associate editor in IEcube Transactions on Sustainable Energy. He's an advocate of sustainable energy and the fight against climate change. His research interests involve renewable energy technologies and distributed energy resources, mainly solar photovoltaics and inverter-based generation, power electronics control, and power system stability. Without further ado, I give the floor to Dr. Batselis, and I hope everyone enjoys his talk.
Right. Thank you, Javier, for this nice introduction. So, it is a pleasure to be presenting today these few slides about one part of my research. That has to do with solar photovoltaic modeling and some applications that we can have with these models in actual PV systems. So let's start it. And I have like one slide with a few words about me so that people understand, the audience and who is talking. So I have been working in the field of solar PV systems and power converters for about 10 years, so that's like my expertise at the moment. And recently I joined as an academic faculty member in the Southampton University. And previous to that, I was a research fellow at Imperial College London, and where I also held an EU Marie Curie fellowship. And actually, this kind of information were included in Javier's introduction, so no need for reiteration. So that's what I have been doing. And today I have a few slides here where I will be trying to explain why it's my research in two, actually it's one field that has to do with PV modeling. And I have classified it here in two parts. So in the first part, I will be talking about the modeling, the theoretical aspect of modeling a PV system, a PV generator. And I will be doing that in an explicit mathematical form. And the second part, I will be explaining how you can use these models in real-time applications to PV systems and trying to convince you that they are important. So starting with the first part of the presentation then, some very basics and fundamental things, because I understand that not everyone in the audience may be familiar with the concepts of solar PV systems. Usually a PV system, PV stands for photovoltaic, right? The basic components of a PV system is a PV generator, which is several solar panels connected in series and in parallel. And also there is the PV inverter. It can be one or two stages. These are really the power electronics that interfacing the DC power to AC and injecting them to the grid. So today's presentation will be mainly focusing on the first on the first component, which is the PV generator. And the PV generator itself has many modules which are connected in series and in parallel to increase the voltage and current, and each module has many cells connected in series. I will not be getting into the details of the structure, but just to understand that we're talking about a modular level, essentially. When you say PV generator, it's many, many modules connected in series and in parallel. And another slide with some basic introductory things, and that's quite actually fundamental for what follows afterwards. One important thing is that the PV cell or module is not a voltage or current source. It has, what do we say, a current voltage characteristic, and you can see that in this graph. We have voltage here in the horizontal axis, we have current in the vertical axis. So each operating point here in this blue curve is one possible combination of voltage and current that the PV cell could be providing to the load, the PV module in this particular curve. And not all these operating points, of course, are of importance to us. Usually, most of our studies and applications involve these three operating points I have highlighted here. There is the source circuit current point, and this actually gives you the maximum current, but at zero voltage. And there's the open circuit point, which gives you the maximum voltage, but zero current. And usually, we need these two operating points for the sizing of the power electronics. But most importantly, what we really care for is the MPP, the maximum power point, which you can see with a purple color, because that gives you the maximum power. And you can see that in the lower curve here, this is power to voltage characteristic, really the product of the integral of this curve with respect to voltage. And you can see that the MPP gives you the maximum power. So let's grasp this basic concept. Depending on the load that the PV panel sees, depending on the power electronics, we can extract a different level of voltage, current, and power. And it's our job to identify what should be the ideal voltage and current to get maximum power. And the other thing I would like just to briefly mention is that all these curves I've been discussing are not constant. They change over time because they highly depend on the operating conditions. And operating conditions is the radiance and temperature, right? The solar radiance incident on the panel that comes from the sun, and the temperature, which of course, it depends on the solar radiance, but also on the wind air and the ambient temperature, et cetera, et cetera. And so these here curves and all these operating points are not constant. They change over time. And this actually makes it even more difficult for real-time applications to keep monitoring, keep tracking of how these points change over time. So that was the introduction of the first part. And let's get started with the mathematics here. Usually, the models, the circuit model we've been using, I mean, the vast majority in the literature for a PV panel and cell, is the single diode model, as we call it. It's this quite simple, frankly, circuit, if you look at it, which is characterized by five parameters. You can see many different, actually, equivalent formulations in the literature, but there are always five parameters. Here we have the photocurrent that is actually, proportional to the solar radiance, and we have two coefficients that relate to the diode and the series and shunt resistances for the non-idealities in the module. So what actually makes this interesting is that when we try to form what we say the voltage current equation of this circuit, is really the terminal voltage with the output current, we have this equation, which again is not too complicated, but it is implicit, which means that the voltage and current are kind of perplexing the equation. They are not separated within the two sides of the equality sign. This means that if I have a particular voltage level and I want to find the current, I need to solve this numerically, iteratively. It is not in explicit form, which is a kind of inconvenience because any kind of numerical and iterative solution, okay, you have a few iterations. Sometimes you may face convergence issues or computational failures, depending on the problem. This is not really the most difficult equation to solve, but it is an advantage if we manage to reformulate it explicitly. And that's something that has been a big portion of the PV modeling theory in the literature have been doing this formulation, which is based on the Lambert W function. And I'm going to talk about it later, but just to make you understand, using the Lambert W function, which is really this W term here, we have a mathematically sound equivalent reformulation of this equation to this equation, which is explicit. You can see here we have voltage to the left, we have current to the right, and the reverse here. So this means that you can solve this equation in a way which is, you know, intuitive and very easy. And also it gives you a good idea of, you know, which component actually, which parameter depends, relates to the current and which depends to the voltage. The first mention of this lambda W was 2007, so it has been like 14 years ago, but it really took off about 10 years ago as an application. And now just a few words about this lambda W function, which personally I quite like. It was firstly proposed by Johann Lambert. That was a great mathematician that lived in 1758, but it was published by, well, we all know Euler, I assume, in 1783. But then it kind of went to the oblivion. It was only recently, let's say, reinvented two or three decades ago when it found applications in quantum physics and electronics and generally anything that has to do with exponential terms in the equation. So what actually means, this is a simplified actually definition, but I will do that for the for easiness of understanding. It's the inverse of x to the e to the x. So if you think about it, the way that, you know, the logarithmic function is the inverse of the exponential function, the lambda w is the inverse of a similar term that involves the proportional and exponential functions. And I have here these plots just to give you an idea of how these two functions compare to grasp the concept. In large arguments, both functions actually, you know, have this logarithmic property of, you know, you increase the argument a lot, but the y value increases just a little. But when it comes to converging to small values of the argument, then you can see that the lambda w converges nicely to zero, which is in contrast to what happens in the logarithmic function, we converge to minus infinity. So it has some interesting properties, and this is why it finds applications in many fields that have to do with electronics and physics. All right, that was the introduction to lambda w. It's a new tool. Not everyone is familiar with that, but the thing is, we have some serious expansion. We can implement it, and most common computational platforms, they have it as a function to use. So I will be using this function quite a lot in the presentation. So that was the reason for this introduction. Let's start with the first thing, which is actually the second thing, because I have already explained how, given we have five parameters, we can come up with the current voltage equation in an explicit form. And now I will be doing that for the three key operating points, namely short circuit, open circuit, and MPP. I mentioned previously why you need them. So about the short circuit and open circuit, it's quite simple, actually. There are marginal operating conditions in the cell, and actually some of these components, the ones that I have now with dashed line, can be neglected because zero current flows through them. So the circuit gets simplified, so it's quite accurate to have these two expressions here for approximating short circuit current, open circuit current. They're not 100% accurate. They have a very, very small negligible error, but it's quite simple to do that, and you have very simple equations, and most people are using these equations for these two points. Okay, so that's solved. What's difficult to do is the maximum power point. And one would expect that to identify the coordinates of the maximum power point, we have really two equations, right? We have one equation that says that, you know, that operating point should be part of the fundamental equation. And we have another equation that says that the derivative of power with respect to voltage should be zero because we get maximum power. So this means we have a system of two nonlinear equations to solve. It requires a numerical solution. Again, it's not the most difficult optimization problem to solve, but it starts getting a little bit more complicated because you have iterations, you have to have a good initialization. I believe it's a convex problem, so you will have a solution anyways, but it would be good if we would be able to, you know, find something equivalent, which is simpler. And that's why my suggestion here is, which is based in this publication, it's about 5 years old now, or six, so it's not that new anymore. The idea is to come up with direct calculation of the MPP. And the way I'm doing that is by introducing a new operating point, which I like to call it MPP-I, MPP-ideal, which is that operating point that the ideal component power gets maximized. So the MPP is when the output of the cell here is the maximum, right? That's the definition. The MPPI is that operating point that if you focus on the internal component only, which is the ideal part, we have the resistances, and if you identify when, at what conditions, this power here gets maximum, then the output would be MPPI. So that's the definition of that. And if you take a look at practical applications, you will see that MPP and MPPI are really very, 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 very close. And that's like, I mean, reasonable to think that when the internal, here is the source of the power, here it is produced, right? So if you get the maximum power here, probably you get the maximum power here. It is not entirely true because you have these two resistances and it may be possible to be a little bit kind of a little bit lower voltage in the internal part, so you will get less series resistance losses. And so what I'm trying to say, this is an approximation, really, theoretically speaking. It's not an equality, but it's an approximation which I have shown that in most practical PV modules yields less than 0.1% error in power estimation. So it's a well-founded approximation. So while I do that, what is the advantage? The advantage is that I can very easily calculate the voltage of the MPP and the current of the MPP, which you can see are simple explicit functions using the five parameters and the term W. And this term W is a number W function of another two parameters. So it's simply two straightforward equations that gives you actually that allows you to calculate very easily the MPP coordinates, but also they really give you an intuition of which parameter affects what and what is the relation of this. So that's another advantage that you can have using these equations. And I have here just a slide of validation. As I said previously, theoretically, we can show that if you have, you know, at least two orders of magnitude between the two resistances, then you have a power error less than 0.1%. And this can be confirmed here with some simulations in about 23 PV modules. And you can see here for different radius and temperature conditions, the maximum error went like that, and that would be the RMS error. And I also had some experimental validation in outdoors conditions where I used 5 PV modules at three different conditions, and I had some equipment where I was really varying a resistive load to capture, you know, the IVA curve at very wide operating range. And then I was trying to see, you know, how my estimation works compared to the measurements. And again, the errors are quite affordable. Of course, in practical applications, they are higher. But even using the single diode model itself, also you get errors of the approximate level. So, you know, these direct equations are as accurate as a single diode model itself when applied in practical conditions. Right, so that was the second part of the first chapter of my presentation. And I have explained so far how you can calculate the IVA characteristic and how you can approximate three of the key operating points, all using explicit and straightforward equations. What I will be doing now is something I haven't done so far, is I haven't explained how to find these parameters. Okay, I mentioned these five parameters, but how to know them? Because unfortunately, we don't know them for every PV module. What is the input data we have is depending on the application. We often have a data sheet that comes from the manufacturer, and the manufacturer has, you know, given a few information about the module, but these involve the key operating points as standard conditions, some coefficients. It does not involve the reference parameters. So we don't know them. And the other input we may have in some cases is measured IVA curves. You know, someone got and measured the IVA curve of the panel and we have that input information. So the project here and the task at hand is how to extract these parameters from the information we have. And I will be focusing mainly on the first approach where you do that only based on data set information because that's more flexible. Quite often people, you know, buy some modules and they have the data sheet. They don't have the equipment to make additional measurements when they're not available. So that is like more easily to implement approach. Again, conventionally, in order to solve that problem, you need to form, of course, a system of five equations because you have parameters. And these four equations are, in most cases, are being used in literature by most approaches. You just apply the fundamental equation at the social condition, open circuit condition, and at the MPP, which is two equations really when it comes to MPP. So you have these four unquestionable equations. And then for the fifth equation, depending on the approach, you can see these three main different approaches in the literature that takes the slope of the curve at particular operating point, and or maybe the temperature dependence of the open circuit voltage to the temperature. So I won't be staying too much on this approach because it's not what I'm doing, but just to let you know that this is not a convex problem. So it's very difficult to find the exact set of five parameters because you have lots and lots of various optima and you don't know what's the appropriate one. And this is not an easy problem to solve. It has to have a very good initialization, it may fail. So this is a headache really to the literature and the scientific community at the moment, how to extract these parameters. And that's why I have tried here to give an analytical and an explicit answer as well. So what I did here is, first I realized that there's a coefficient which I decided to christen it as delta node. That's come from the Greek letter delta. And this coefficient is the relation between the modified Dido equality factor and the open circuit voltage at standard test conditions. So it's this ratio. And I have shown for crystalline modules, this coefficient is really actually a function of some constants, some numbers which do not change, and the temperature coefficients available in the datasheet. So this gives me really one very important piece of information about the diode coefficient of the PV modules, which previously were not known. And this is really interesting and useful in the next step. But just to highlight again, this is valid only for crystalline modules because it involves the silicon energy band gap. So once you have calculated this coefficient, which you can do that very simply from data information, you calculate the W node, which is another auxiliary parameter. Again, number W of something here involves delta node. And once you have done these two straightforward steps, then you can really apply these equations I previously mentioned, the short circuit one, open circuit one, and MPP OER. If you just use them and reverse engineer, really, you assume that you know the coordinates of the key points and you just need to find the parameters, then you apply them in this order. You identify the modified diode equality factor, and then the series resistance, and then the shunt resistance, and then the photocurrent, and then the saturation current. Again, I think no need to focus too much on the mathematics here. Just that I just would like to give the impression that we just apply these equations explicitly one after another, and it's very simple to do that, and no iterations, no any potential for inconvergence or failure. That's like the advantage we do with that. Well, of course, whenever we get something which is whenever we simplify something and getting a computationally efficient version of it, we lose out a little bit in accuracy. But my claim here is that this, this loss in accuracy is acceptable. Of course, depending on the application, always. So in this slide, I have some validation information. We had like about 8,000 scenarios in 20 PV modules, where you can see this 3D graph here. We captured, actually what we did is that we extracted the parameters through my method, and then we reconstructed the IVA curve. And because we had the actual IVA curve, we made a comparison. And that comparison in terms of current is like arometric on how well this parameter extraction works. And you can see here that the maximum error was about 1%, and the RMS was a little bit less than 0.5%. And we repeated this process with outdoors conditions in 5 PV modules at 3 different conditions. And here we made a comparison with another 3 well-used methods of analytical extraction of 5 parameters. So just to highlight here, all these methods are analytical ones, are the ones that do not need iterations. Because if you get one with iterations, you have higher accuracy, of course, right? So I'm comparing only the explicit ones. And what I'm saying here is that the proposed method achieves better accuracy, actually, both in RMS and maximum. So that's like the advantage of it. Okay, and now I'm completing the first part of the presentation with the modeling aspects. I have explained how to find the reference parameter, but I haven't really explained also how we change, how these parameters change with irradiance and temperature, because they change, of course. I mean, everyone knows that when you have more irradiance on the solar panel, it produces more power, right? So here I have adopted five of the most well-known and well-used equations for translating. I like to use this word, but it's really, you know, extrapolating the reference value that the parameter has at some standard conditions to any condition that relates to irradiance and temperature. These, again, are explicit functions, so no need for further discussion. So just to give you then the complete glimpse of what is this complete PV model now, we start, whenever we need to do something with a PV panel, PV array, PV generator, whatever, we start with some inputs. And here I have taken just dataset inputs, which is the least minimum set you can have. The first thing is you extract the five parameters, which are the ones with a zero at their subscript. And you do that explicitly with equations I explained. And then what you do is, if you want to, you know, calculate something at different irradiation temperature, not the standard ones, but some different, you know, irradiation temperature arbitrary, then you use these translation equations, which are also explicit. And then you have the five parameters that correspond to a particular set of irradiation temperature. And then, again, depending on what you want to do, you can either just calculate the IVA curve or PV curve. You have to have the entire curve. And that, again, can be done explicitly through lambda W function. Or if you're going to just identify what's the maximum current of the module or the maximum voltage for the purposes of designing the power electronics, or if you want to know what's the maximum power, which is the most actually useful actually thing of all this modeling, you can use again my equations, which are again explicit. So the only thing I'm trying here to explain is that that's a complete model that doesn't have any kind of iteration whatsoever. So this makes it much more easy and straightforward to be applied. Of course, you lose out a little bit in accuracy, but I claim that it is acceptable. And the important part is, you know, when and what are the applications who really need this simplicity in terms of modeling. And that's why what I will be discussing now in the second part of my presentation. So that's actually, I'm going to the second part now. I can see that we are already 25 minutes, so that's going well. Before I start with with the technical things of this part, I would like just to mention one or two things about the solar picture today for the audience that may not be that familiar with that. It has been remarkable. The deployment of solar has been remarkable the past 10 years. I mean, most people know that, and especially in Spain, it was one of the leading countries, so you know that very well. But there is also a cloud in the sky, as we say, because we have seen that solar has started stagnating in many markets. And especially if you see the European market was the one that was leading in the first, you know, the previous decade. Now we can see that it has kind of leveled off. And there are many reasons for that. Some of those are related to financing, to markets, etc. But also there are lots of technical reasons because why we can't have too much solar power in our networks. It doesn't have to do with solar itself. It has to do with renewable energy being intermittent. It has to do with not having actually the energy during the night and when you need it. It has to do with power electronics. We have some peculiar qualities. So what I'm trying to say here is that the UK as well is not a stranger to this trend. It started very, very strongly, but now it has leveled off. And just to mention that, quite interestingly, in the UK we have about 17% solar integration level, which is quite high for a weather which is famously, you know, known for cloudiness and rain, etc. So it's quite well. So if in the UK we can have almost 20% of integration, the rest of Europe should have much more than that, and it does not. So that's actually one of the big things we are tackling in this white paper that we are presenting next week. So I would encourage any one of you that would like to know more about the technical aspects of integration, you can just click on this website. We will be uploading the white paper today or tomorrow. And if you can join the launch event, it is free. We'll have a few very interesting talks to explain how we should really work for having more solar in the global power system. But after having this introduction, I try to explain to you that we have many problems when it comes to putting a lot of solar energy into the power system. And in this white paper, we are proposing you know, a roadmap of directions which are really important. And one of the most important ones is what I like very much to say, make the PV systems more grid-friendly. Right, grid-friendly means a lot of things, but it really means that to make the solar plant a little bit more dispatchable power station, a power station that can support the grid during disturbances, that can change its output based on what the grid wants. There are a lot of things that this keyword means, but what I will be focusing on the next of the presentation is a requirement to make grid-friendly, which is to keep power reserves. Power reserves is what you understand is just to have some energy in reserve that can be deployed instantly when needed. And of course, this is something that was quite easy and intuitive to do in the, in a coal power station, because you had some more fuel stored in the, in a storage, and you could leverage, you could increase your output whenever you need it. But of course, you understand that this is not easy to do when you have a solar plant, when you have a wind park, because you're trying to extract the maximum energy available. You cannot burn more sun, right? It's not a fuel. So what can you do then? How is it possible? How would it be possible to have a solar plant that will give you the option to increase your output on command to be more grid friendly? And there are two options here. One of the first thing that people thought was energy storage, usually batteries, because they work quite well. And that's something that's going quite well indeed. But we have to appreciate that involves lots of additional installation costs and survey costs. There's also another option, and that's what I will be focusing for the next presentation, which I find it personally very interesting, is the whole idea of deliberately operating a little bit less than the maximum of the power at any time, so that you keep a power margin to be used as reserves. So what I'm saying essentially is that at any operating point, at any time of the day, even though you could extract the maximum power of the solar generator, you deliberately work a little bit less, like 80% or 90%, 95%, depending on your needs. So you keep that margin of the time available to be deploying when there's a need. Now, that's something that most people, when they hear them the first time, they think that it's kind of bad because we don't really, explore all the solar energy we have. But if you think it a second, it's a bit greedy as well, because it has to do with the sustainability of the power system as a whole. And at the moment, what happens is that the solar technology has become very cheap. It has become very cheap itself, and it's now cheaper to install a solar plant rather than to install a coal power plant or a gas fired power plant. So what I'm trying to say is that it has started being kind of reasonable to say that I deliberately oversize my plant by 5% or 10% so that I can be all the time curtailing a small amount. And with that approach, I will have an energy which is more supportive of the grid, so it has higher value. So even though you're kind of underutilizing your PV capacity a little bit, you give more value to the rest of the energy being injected because it supports the grid better. And that's like a balance that at the moment the system operators are trying to meet. The scientific community is thinking about these things at the moment. They have not converged to what exactly is the appropriate mix of the two approaches. But what I'm trying to explain here is that it is interesting to do technically. So how to do that technically then, if you decide to, keep some power reserves by curtailing power? Mainly there are two options. If you have a very large megawatt plan, and each of these boxes correspond to a different PV cluster, you have modules and an inverter, different clusters, you can instruct some of those to operate at maximum power, like 100%, and the rest of those at reduced power. And as a whole, they give, a reduced output level that meet your target. So that's very easy to do, but it has the problem that also it's very easy to monitor the maximum power when you do that, because you have all these 100% boxes that work as pilots, and they keep track of the maximum power as it changes over the day. However, the whole problem here that I will be discussing in the next slide is that it's not very accurate because you may have clouds passing by and all these components may not be identical. So this is simple to do, but it is not very accurate. The other approach you have is to have the entire PV plant, all the components operating at the exact operating level, like 80% in this example. This is something that ideally we should do because it doesn't have any limitations. The problem here is that it is more challenging to monitor the maximum power, because if you operate less than the maximum power, how do you really know what is the maximum power? That's the question. I will be discussing that in one of the next slides. But just here to present a few of the results of the National Renewable Energy Laboratories in the United States that have worked on the first approach that says that, you know, we instruct some of these PV clusters to operate at 100%, some of those in 60%, and we try to estimate the maximum power. And they have seen that during cloudy days, when clouds passing by, you have really a distribution of irradiance across the plant. And this extrapolation does not really work very accurately. So it's still an open issue. So let's start now with the control aspects of how a PV system should work when you keep some power reserves. And this is what is my approach. This is where you actually, all the PV clusters, all the inverters operate at the curtail level. What this really means is, let's take a look at this power to voltage curve that I presented in the second slide of my presentation. I have explained that, you know, conventionally you would like to operate at the MPP because that gives you the maximum power. What we're saying now is something different. You would like to operate at the curtail level, which is this dashed line here, that gives you that margin as a headroom that could be deployed when needed. For example, you are here. If you need in the next second to reduce your power, you can always do that. If you need to increase your power, you can also do that up to, I don't know, 20%, whatever the reserves are. So that gives you the grid friendliness we discussed previously. Now, the technical difficulties with this approach is that because this curve is non-monotonic, you don't have one, you have two operating points, your candidate operating points that can meet this power reference. And that's not a good thing, that's a bad thing, because it makes the control more complicated. And if you take a look at these two sides, the left side and the right side, they have different properties. The left-hand side, the left operating point, it has the problem that it cannot go to too low voltage because then you need the power electronics to boost your voltage a lot, which sometimes is not possible after a point. It is not very efficient. You have some losses. But it is a little bit more robust at fast irradiance changes. Operating at this part of the curve is something I personally favor because it's more versatile. You operate at the voltage level, which is perfectly acceptable. It's better for high conversion efficiency. But you need to do that properly because when the irradiance changes fast, it may be possible that you go to instability. So you have to design properly your control scheme. And what I would like here to mention is the fundamentals of how you control actually your PV system in that case. So now in this circuit, I have now some basic components of the PV system, the PV generator and the converter. This is a two-stage converter. And what you have really, you have you know, a PI controller that compares a reference power level and the measured power level and what outputs the duty cycle that is fed into a pulse width modulator that drives the inverter, the converter. So if you don't do anything and you just leave it as it is, you have a problem. You have a problem mainly because of the non-monotonic relation of the output and input of the PI controller. So what I have tried to show here with this graph is that depending on where your operating point was and where you want to go, it may be possible to go into stability. You will go here. If you're here, again, the control will drive you to your target. But if it happens, your operating point momentarily being shifted to that part, then it will lead you to instability. And that's something which is detrimental. We don't want this kind of stuff in our controllers, in actual PV systems. So that's one of the things that we have proposed, which is a modification of the curve. And if you take a look at this control scheme, it's similar to the previous one. I mean, quite intuitive and simple in its essence. Again, you have a reference power, you're comparing with a power value, but this is not the actual measured value. This is an extrapolated, like a translated power value that corresponds to this red dashed line. So let's take a moment just to understand here what I'm showing. So you have this red line, which I call it modified PV curve, that in the right-hand side of the PV curve, it's the same thing, they match, but in the left side, it is like a mirrored version of this blue part passing through a horizontal line that passes from the MPP. So what I'm saying here is that instead of, for any operating point, instead of giving that power here as an input to the controller, I'm giving the corresponding level that the corresponding power that lies on the red line. So this means that if the operating point is here, then it is the actual value, it will guide it here to the target. But if it happens for any reason, the operating point to be shifted at the left, then the translated value will be always higher than MPP, because that's how it has been designed, and therefore it will be driven back to the right place. So really what I've done here is like I have made an equivalent monotonic version of power voltage characteristic, nothing more than that, only to avoid you know, operating at the left-hand side with something bad in my control. So that's the contribution here to make this control, you know, stable and robust at any conditions. And the keen observer may have seen that in order to do that, it's simply a piecewise linear equation, very simple. But if you do that, you need PMP and VMP. You need the coordinates of the MPP. So now we start realizing that when we want a PV system to operate under these complicated conditions, we need real-time estimations of the maximum power point, the VMP and PMP, and we need them in real-time and very fast and very quickly and very robustly. And there's no time for simulations, etc. So how do you do that? You do that through the models that I explained previously. So let me go into the details. This is another chapter here that has to do with how to estimate the MPP in real time. This is really what we need to do. Again, if you want to know what is the maximum power of your solar plant for a year, this is energy yield calculations. You can do that in your computer. You don't need, you know, you don't even need these simple models I presented because you have a very strong computer. But when it comes to an embedded application, you have a microcontroller that has some specific standards and very limited computational capacity, you need something simple that you are entirely sure it's going to run properly. So that's why this is difficult to do. And there are three mainly approaches in the literature on MPP estimation. There is this approach that you use irradiance and temperature sensors to do, which is easy and simple, but it doesn't really work properly. Because it has a lot of measurement errors and is not reliable for real-time applications. This is only for energy yield applications. And then this is the, something I already explained. If you have the luxury to have identical components and conditions, you can extract some of your inverters to operate at the MPPT, some at the cartel level, and then you extrapolate. So that's very simple, and it can work fine, but you will have probably estimation accuracy errors when there is differentiation here of the components. So generally speaking, the model-based estimation is the one which is the most reliable, is the most widely, you know, applicable to any situation you may have. But of course, it's sophisticated. Okay, it is not simple. You need to apply models and mathematically, and you need to do a lot of stuff. So that's what I'm explaining in the next few slides. The basic concept is shown in this curve. So what happens here is that the actual PV curve is the blue line. You can see that. And the operating point would be somewhere here, okay, at the loaded level. So all these model-based MPP estimation methods have some basic, some common things. They try to capture some actual voltage and current measurements from the operating region and use them to apply a model, a PV model, that is going to estimate the MPP or the rest of the curve. That's like what all the models do. In my particular proposition involves the full single diode PV model I explained previously. And in order to be accurate, what I do is I deliberately oscillate the operating point a little bit up and down through the target. This is not a bad thing in terms of power, because little up and little down compensate themselves. So the average power will be exactly as you want it. But while you're oscillating, you really capture lots and lots of samples because you have high measurement frequency in your controller. And that really gives you what you need, the inputs you need in order to apply the PV model and extract the parameters that you want. So let's start with the equations then. You may remember the single diode PV model, and we have also the five reference parameters that we have extracted, you know, offline. Not during the application of the algorithm. So what we really need to do is, if you take a look at this equation here, this is really the fundamental equation solved differently, where I have the known inputs is the current and voltage that I have for every voltage and current sample. And the red colored variables, irradiance and temperature, is the things that I don't know. So what really matters during real-time applications is the irradiance and temperature and how they change. And I cannot measure them effectively through sensors. So I need to extract them through the voltage and current samples. And that's what I'm doing here. And applying this equation is a solution to that. But of course, this is not very simple because you have one equation and two unknowns. So you cannot just apply this equation at every sample. You know, do something more complicated. And then curve fitting comes into picture, non-linear least squares optimization. So my suggestion is, what I said previously, I oscillate the operating point up and down the target level so that you capture a measurement window, a lot of samples in a vicinity of like 2 or 3% in terms of power. And then what you need to do is just you apply this optimization here, just you know, make one iteration into curvaging and extracting radius and temperature. And whenever you do that, you have an update of radius and temperature, you translate the five parameters, and then you apply these explicit MPP equations I proposed, so that you have the MPP coordinates at any iteration. So that's the basic concept of the algorithm. I'm not getting into more technical details for the sake of this presentation. Just to mention here that, unfortunately, this is very complicated and it is not explicit. That's the only non-straightforward thing I'm doing here. But I have the advantage that because your radius and temperature, you know, do not change very fast compared to the microcontrollers' timings, what I'm really doing is just I'm at every iteration, like every 20 milliseconds, I'm applying you know, one iteration for this algorithm, so it really converges all the time towards the actually radius and temperature, and it keeps track of that. So that's actually like how we have overcome the computational burden. And just a few results, which are experimental here. We have a 2 kilowatt actual PV inverter and some, you know, oscilloscopes and an actual PV string of 12 modules. I have a video at the end of the slide. We're gonna take a look at the setup. And here I have, you know, the power over time, how it changes. You can see with the green and purple, these are the actual PMP, the actual maximum power, and how the algorithm estimates all the time during its operation, which you can see is curtailed. So the blue line is, you know, the actual delivered power, and the red line is what we would like it to be. I'm just giving some step commands for the experiment. So you can see that even though it moves away from the operating point, from the maximum power point, it keeps track of the maximum power. But more interestingly, take a look at this figure where we do the exact same thing, only that we change the effective irradiance because we have actually a panel that we're changing its tilt. And you do that very quickly. You do that in just 10 seconds. So it's like an extreme change of irradiance, almost unrealistic. And even though we're doing at that time, you can see that the algorithm manages to operate where it should operate at the same time, keep track of the maximum power as it changes over time. So that's the kind of thing we need in this kind of applications. Right, so in the interest of time, let me go to the next method then. I have just another two methods to show you. So this is really an improvement of the previous method that we published quite recently. And it's just tailored for very fast irradiance changes. Because what we saw is that even though during the day, you know, the sun moves quite slowly, so our algorithm works perfectly fine, it may be possible in very windy and cloudy days, you have clouds passing by very quickly, and this creates this radiance transients. So at such high radiance transients, it may be possible our algorithm to fail, and not just our algorithm, every algorithm available in the literature at the moment, model-based estimator. So that was like the motivation we had for this improvement here. And what it did, just a small tweak, which is actually surprisingly effective. We thought that, you know, even though radiance may change very, very fast, this is not true for temperature, because temperature depends on the thermal inertia of the system, thermal inertia of the modules, of the environment. You need really minutes to start seeing differences in the cell temperature. So what we did, we thought, okay, if you use the previous equation, this is really that equation, okay? And if I solve it for irradiance, which is G here, you have this form, which is very simple and explicit, and you have irradiance to the left and the rest of it to the right. So if you say, okay, let us assume that the temperature does not change over the time, let's keep it constant for, I don't know, every 5 seconds, and only every 5 seconds question whether this is right or wrong. This gives you the luxury to, for most of the time, to just have one equation for one unknown. That's like the big thing you gain here. So it's very easy. For every sample you get, which is the blue VI, And assuming that the temperature remains constant, you can just find the new reagents value at any you know sample. So that makes it much more robust and reliant, especially during these transients. So the revised flowchart is really what I explained previously. For every sample you have, you assume that the temperature remains the same, and you calculate the new reagents using this equation, which is one equation for one unknown, very simple, straightforward, no any kind of computational difficulties. And just every sort of every once in a while, every few seconds, you say, okay, let us have now a perturbation to update because it may be possible that temperature has changed for half a degree or something. So in that case, we do really what we did previously. We have a perturbation, we capture a measurement window, and then we apply curve fitting to update both irradiance and temperature. And very quickly, I'm going to give you some results which are similar to the previous ones, with the whole difference that we have now intense solar irradiance changes. These are actual measured irradiance values, by the way. And you can see that what happens and what is being estimated matches very well, even though it changes such quickly. And at the same time, we have a slower change of temperature. And again, our going follow is very accurately, but you can see the small steps here because it's for 5 seconds. This is why it changes only every 5 seconds. And this is reflected to the maximum power profile. Again, it matches the actual maximum power very accurately. And that's the output of the inverter, which is the maximum minus a certain level of reserves. The only thing I would like here to mention is that you have my blue color, the PV side power, and with yellow color, the grid side power. So it's the power, but one is at the input and the other is at the output when it goes to the grid. So you may see these blue spikes at the PV side because we have this 5 seconds oscillation to update the conditions. But these are not transferred to the grid because you have the DC link and you have some capacitors and a clever control that filters out these oscillations. So it's not a problem. No any kind of oscillation reaches the grid. Okay, and let me complete this session then by the third and final method, which is even more complicated than what I've said so far. So I have kept it only in illustrated level. This refers to the conditions we call partial shading. So partial shading is when we have different level of irradiance on parts of the PV string. So you have like two modules shaded here, for example, at 50%, and the others operating at different irradiance. So things are getting complicated there because you have some bypass diodes and the resulting power voltage characteristic doesn't even have just one MPP. It has two MPPs here in this example, or generally it can have even more than that. So it is much more difficult to, to monitor what's the shading, what's the maximum power, how it changes. It's very difficult to do. And we have done just a small step towards solving this problem, which applies only for PV strings and two radiance levels. So only when you have modules in series, and you have just a portion shaded and the other unshaded. It doesn't work for many levels. The idea is quite similar to what I have presented so far. So again, you're operating around the target so that you capture the curvature of the curve and you apply a more complicated version of the model I have explained. And doing that gives you the shading conditions, the irradiances, etc. So you can apply then all these explicit equations to know what is the actual pivot curve to estimate it essentially and have also good estimations about the MPPs and the other operating points. So let's just go directly to the results here, which are a little bit more interesting maybe. So using the same experimental setup I showed previously, what we did here is we used some semi-transparent fabric that we used a system of pulleys and ropes to cover and uncover the modules in a way that it's controllable. Right, so this emulates a very fast shading situation. And you can see the results here in this power to time plot. So that's the maximum power, and you can see that it decreases over time as we shade a portion of the PV string, and then when we unshade it, it increases again. And during that time, our algorithm manages to track very effectively the target, and at the same time estimate with a small error only what's happening out there. And you can see here 4 spikes each time each module is shaded or unshaded, which are just in the PV side, and it has to do with the abruptness of how quickly we do that. And before I go out to the video, just also to mention that these are the different characteristic curves that correspond to the different shading conditions. And the blue points are the sampled, and the red is the estimated ones. So you can see it's quite reasonably good approximation. What I'm trying to say here is that even though we operate at just a small portion of the curve, using the appropriate models, you manage to know whatever happens to the entire other curve, which is very interesting, because you can have power yield estimations, we can know, we can monitor the situation of the PV string and everything. So this is useful generally. And yeah, so this is an animated video where I'm trying to show you how this kind of most sophisticated version of the algorithm works. We have like 12 modules connected in series. I'm just showing here 4 of those, and we are pushing with some ropes this this semi-transparent fabric. Okay, and during that time, our algorithm works. And you can see here, this is a figure that I have animated for you. This is the shadow extent, you know, what percentage of the PV string is being shaded over time. You can see initially it's 0, and then as it is being shaded, it increases up to 33%, because I have 4 modules out of 12. That is 33%. And then when it starts being shaded, the algorithm on its own understands what's happening. So there is no cameras, no anything, just from the voltage and current measurements, it perceives the situation. And this is why it allows the operation with this power to time plot I explained previously. During that time, it captures the maximum power as it changes and manages to keep track of the target of what actually the grid operator requests from it. Okay, so that was it mainly. If you would like to know more about this piece, you can find some of the publications here. And yeah, thank you very much for your attention. I will be very keen to answer any questions.
Thank you very much, Stratios. Right now start the question times. Please remember to raise your hand. Thank you very much.
Okay, I don't know if I have to be the first in speaking, but anyway, doesn't matter. Well, first of all, I would like to congratulate Dr. Batselis for his nice and clear talk. It's been really interesting, and I have a lot of questions, but I think it's not time to. We don't have time to explain to speak about them. But I'd like to ask a couple of questions that maybe other people in the audience can ask. Well, the advantages of explicit methods are clear, especially when you want to obtain instant data or when you want to implement them, for example, in microcontrollers. But I would like to know what are the disadvantages of these methods compared to, for example, numerical methods, and so when numerical methods should be used instead of explicit ones. Right. Okay, yeah. This is.
Shall I answer the question one to one, or would you like?
No, yes, one to one.
Right. So thank you for that, Javier. It's a good question indeed. So it really depends on the application, as you said. In a microcontroller embedded application, you need something that runs fast. So in that case, you may be okay to lose a little bit in accuracy. But for when you want to have, for example, energy calculations, so you're a PV installer and you know you have a customer, and the customer wants to know what will be the energy that we'll have in 1 year from the solar park. So if you're going to do that, you know, or commercial software like PV system, etc., they have some procedures. And in that case, it may be totally okay for the algorithm to run numerically and extract the parameters, you know, for a few minutes. And once they have the reference parameters, they don't, you know, care that much about time execution in that case. So it's always a balance about the application. And yeah, also it's about the versions of the model. So generally, when it comes to reference parameters, I believe it's much more acceptable to allow some time and get the exact version of those, because you need them once, the reference parameters, the ones that correspond to standard test conditions. Other steps of the model, you may need them more quickly. For example, the MPP estimation, you may need to apply to a time series many, many times. So there, again, computational burden is something important. So if you don't do that explicitly, you need to know that your numerical solution is 100% accurate. There is no chance for any, you know, failure, and it runs as fast as you need it.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I agree with you. Thank you. And the other question is a general one. It's about the applications of well, you know, there are a lot of applications, but how do you think we could convince solar panel manufacturers to use the new existing methods to update their data sheets with more reliable and accurate data?
So essentially what you say is, why the manufacturers don't they include the reference parameters in the dataset?
Yeah, exactly.
That was like the first question when I started my PhD, I don't know, many years ago. That was the first question I asked my supervisor back then. Why don't they do that? And he said to me, two reasons, because then we wouldn't have a job to do as researchers. That was kidding. The second thing is that there is not really, you know, a common consensus about the manufacturers. The manufacturers that just need, you know, some very, you know, some characteristics that are not questionable. They just measure the associated current, the maximum power at certain conditions, and they just go to the production. They don't care about these things we care.
Yeah.
So, and you can see there are many standards, standards like the IEC standard and the ASME standard. There are standards that have proposed some equations and some models, but still not the entire scientific community, you know, agrees with all these models. Mm-hmm. So that's the main problem.
Yeah. But you know, my question is because, you know, we use sometimes the data of these data sheets, and we are comparing our methods with this data, but maybe they are wrong or they are not exact, or then maybe we have to do something to have a good solutions, a good numbers. Which are not from them, from the manufacturers, because as I'm saying, maybe they are not a good data.
Yeah, you have a point here. Yeah, you have a point, but I don't know. only standardization is a solution to that. If there was a world standard that was compelling the manufacturers to input some additional information, it could be also in digital form. For example, most manufacturers, you don't know what are the measured IVA curves. Even though they measured them, they're not available to the audience. That could be like a digital asset connected to the dataset. That could be very easily done, but they don't do it. So, you know, if there was an interest in the community, maybe there could be a standard that was compelling. It would make it mandatory for the manufacturers to do it, and then that could be maybe the solution.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Javi. Right now, Agusias, go ahead.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, first of all, I would like to thank to Stratios for the nice presentation today. I think it's a nice topic. We have also a lot of opportunities to collaborate with people here as well, with Javier and Jose Manuel. They are also working in similar topics as well. So I am really very curious in some aspects of this photovoltaic. First of all, I would like to know your opinion about the power reserve. So
yes.
Do you think this is a real interest for all parties? Industry, manufacturers, even the electrical companies, to focus on this kind of control, because as you said, it's quite interesting, because this, that the similar way that traditional power plants work, but now for photovoltaic, just taking less power from the PV plant, but adapting the power you really need in a particular income. So do you think this is interest in the future for this?
Yes, thank you, Osias Garrigos. Hope that I pronounced it correctly. That's a question that I get quite often. Let me say something. Yes, I definitely believe that this is in the future, but maybe this is because I'm working on it. So let me just change the arguments. When you have a gas-fired power plant, right, and you just decide to burn 8% of the available fuel, I mean, the fuel you could have. Does anyone care about that? No, because you have used to just the OPEX cost, the operational cost of the power plant, to be strongly related to the fuel costs. Now we have entered an era where the basic renewables like solar and wind have near zero marginal operating costs. So it's like a zero, almost zero cost of the fuel. So the energy power system sector is changing, is transitioning to something different. So underutilizing your capacity is not such a big thing, since you are not losing, you're not really losing fuel. You just don't extract, you just don't use all the capacity you have. It's like a manufacturing process that has a big manufacturing plant, but you know it doesn't work during the weekends. So it's really underutilization of capacity. Bear this in mind. Of course, I mean, if you just get paid for the kilowatt hour, you lose revenues. That's totally right. But what if you have some extra revenue streams? And what's happening at the moment is that what we see National Grid here in the UK and in the European power system is, because you have all these ambitious targets of increasing renewables and the green power and reducing CO2 costs, it is more important to, you know, have started facing actually challenges, technical challenges in the power system. And in order to solve them, we need to make investments. We need to move more energy storage, for example. We need to pay some extra costs to give reserves by the fuel power systems. So this is a cost. If you manage to, you know, reduce that cost by underutilizing the PV capacity, then you have an equation with you can strike a balance. And indeed, there is already a financial instrument at the moment, which is the ancillary services market and the reserves market, which is something that theoretically, you know, could be related to PV plants, curtailing power. But I'm not aware of any actual installation that is doing that at the moment. So it's something of the future mainly. But I'm trying to really look ahead, because if you see the latest report of IRENA's, of IRENA, you will see that now, you know, the solar plant is the single technology which is cheaper than any other generation technology worldwide. It's cheaper than wind, it's cheaper than fuel, it's cheaper than coal, it's cheaper than everything. So if it gets keep cheaper, would it be more economically efficient to just, you know, oversize it a bit, like 5%, and you know, committing that percentage only for the purpose of keeping reserves? So it's not something that it's people that have started working on it. My first publication on this issue was in 2016, and at that time, everyone was saying, okay, this is not going to go ahead. But now you have started seeing big institutions like National Renewable Energy Laboratory at the United States, and you can see, you know, all the reports by esteemed institutions are saying that maybe something it's worth investigating, mainly because solar has become cheap. And I'm not saying that it is like the only solution, because everything in engineering is hybridization, a mixture of many different things. But personally, I feel that when Spain probably would like to increase amount of solar into the grid, and they say, the operator says, okay, you have to invest these kind of millions in energy storage, and also, you know, some of the existing parts, they just can curtail a little bit, maybe you can find the perfect balance, financially speaking.
Yeah, because now there is for the new European funding, there is a topic, especially for the storage in hydrogen. So there is. I was wondering if you can manage just with PV and wind energy and minimizing the storage.
Definitely, Osiris. Energy storage is going to be the future. I don't want to get you confused. Of course, energy storage is the future in our European energy system, using hydro, using hydrogen, using batteries, everything. So this is going to be present. But the whole thing, but we will still have, for example, some gas-fired power stations that will run using natural gas. We still need them operational-wise. And we'll have some solar plants and wind curtailing. We'll have everything. And to find the proper mixture, it's a market, it's a techno-economical analysis we need to do.
Okay, just the last, but it's a technical. What is the time constant you are talking about when you are doing your power reserve loops?
Sorry, what is it, the time constant you said?
What's the time you are talking about?
Right. So, okay. That question could have two answers. So, is one thing is how quickly I can do that as a PV system, and the other thing is how quickly the operator needs it.
Yeah.
So the good thing with the PV system is that it can do absolutely instantly. When I'm saying instantly, I'm saying in 20 milliseconds, less than one fundamental cycle of the AC side. Because I don't have any inertia, any actual mechanical inertia in the PV system, because it's bad and it's good things. The good thing, I can change the operating point almost instantly. The power electronics are very fast, and I can implement any reserves level in a matter of just a few tens and hundreds of milliseconds. So the operator, depending on the services, if we want to commit it for primary frequency response, you may be familiar with that. You need to respond to a power imbalance in the power system because the frequency is going to change. So that's something usually you need that to be deployed in 1 or 2 seconds, up to 5 seconds. That's like a few seconds time period. So you are already too fast about that. But there are more than that, Osir. There are more than that. There is inertia response when you are strongly coupled to the grid and you operate like a synchronous machine and trying to minimize small deviations in frequency. There's a new concept that is called grid foaming for inverters, which again believe that it is the future and you need again reserves. And I would just really encourage you to visit that website. And maybe if you are able to attend next week's white paper launch event, because we really tackle all these things from the power system operator thing. Today I presented more of the PV modeling aspects, but all these questions will be answered actually next week.
Okay. Thank you very much
for the questions. Right now, go ahead, Blanes, José Manuel.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for your talk. Very interesting. Some questions related. One question related with your estimated method for the MPP or the cure.
Yeah.
We worked in the past in estimating the MPP or the cure of a photovoltaic model with a small perturbation about the working point, like you did. And if I didn't misunderstood, I think that you do a precalculation of the initial parameters from the dataset data, and then you do a calculation in the microcontroller or whatever you are using. After that, using the small perturbation, then I wonder. As we know, the photovoltaic modules, as they get older, they change the characteristics. So the data from the dataset is good just when the module is out of the box. But if we are talking about installations that they are going to work for 10 years or 15 years, how are you going to deal with this? Are you going to recalculate the data or something like that?
Yeah, right, Blanes, thank you very much. Very keen observation indeed. So we have a solution to that. That is very, very, that's correct. And it is not only aging that the module changing from year to year, but you may have also additional components in your power circuit that they're increasing the resistance. You may have, for example, log cables. Log cables increase the series resistance. So the PV generator that it is being perceived by the power electronics may be a little bit different than the one you thought to be. So the best way to tackle these issues is to just update the reference parameters from the microcontroller in an offline routine once in a while, once in a few months or once in a year, something like that. So that's something in this publication we had a very small part where we're explaining how this can be done. Essentially, you need for a few minutes to kind of get off grid, of course, because at that time you cannot operate normally. So you just change the duty cycle of the converter and you capture the IV curve from the microcontroller. And you have some time then, because you do that like offline, to apply on the methods that extract these parameters. It could be my method, it could be many other methods that use the entire of a curve, if you want it to be. Preferably one method that it is not very, very, very complicated. And it can be calculated in the microcontroller. Not in 1 second, maybe in 1 minute, maybe in 10 minutes. That's something you can afford. And you do that, you have updated your parameters, and then you carry on. You're working for the one year, and then maybe another year, you repeat it again.
Okay, thank you. And just other question about the setting estimation. Do you use sensors in that method, irradiance and temperature sensor or not?
No, this is the thing. I haven't used any sensors in any of this research because I have seen that the radar sensors have some margin errors and the temperature sensors more errors. And the communication also with the microcontroller is kind of problematic. It's not something you can have in a millisecond resolution. So no, any sensor at all. It's just a PV model, which is, of course, more complicated than that. It's more complicated than that because it has the shading components. And it manages to capture what's happening by only the voltage and current samples. If you want more information, you can find this in this paper here. The reason that we have managed to do that with just voltage and current measurements is because we have contained it to PV strings and to radiance levels. I'm just repeating that once more time, because if you had three radiance levels, that wouldn't work accurately. And also, during that, there is a flowchart where when the shading starts, there is also a deviation of the periodic point, which is wider, so that it captures the shading ratio. So we do one of two things that I didn't explain very in much detail here. But to answer your question, yes, I'm not using any sensor, any current, any irradiance or temperature sensor.
OK, thank you. I will write the paper in detail. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Congratulations, Stratis, for your talk. My question is about another possibility of a computation of the parameters of the MPP model, because the more analytical you have explained, the more the analytical is to compute the MPP power. Could be possible also use the new trends in machine learning to compute with the experience of the of the points and compute and train a neural network, and after that, from the new data of irradiance and temperature, compute the new points of the model. Could be used machine learning to do this task without knowing the exact analytical model.
Yeah, thank you, Vicente. Very good question. Yes, indeed, you can do that, and there is of course already published literature on that. And just to clear out, what actually you're referring to is not extracting the reference parameters, but the whole situation of extracting the parameters, translating the parameters, and estimating also the maximum power in real time. So you can train a model. Actually, personally, I have done it as well. You can train a neural network. It doesn't have to be very, very much complicated. If you have lots of data, and just by operating in a particular voltage or current, then you can have some estimations about other parts of the curve. So that's something that can be done. So the challenge you will be facing if you apply data-driven approach, a blind data-driven approach that doesn't have any part of this modeling inside it, is that you will need a tremendous amount of data to train it properly. So you have two options. Either do you do that offline using only simulation model, so you're using kind of my models to produce data and then train your neural network. But of course, this has the challenges we discussed with planners previously, that you may have inaccuracies in actuality, or then you have the actual PV plant, and how you can deploy that? Will the PV owner be willing to have like 1 year just training the model? Because 1 day will not be as efficient. Okay. So that's the big problem we have with data-driven approaches in almost everything. If you can bypass them and you have something that, you have used your data-driven, like from the human mind, and you have included all this information inside it, then it is a plug-and-play algorithm. You put it, it runs in an actual system. Or maybe you can have a calibration, like we said previously, using it just a few minutes. If you just don't use all this model information we have produced as scientists, and we just put a black box, and we need tremendous amount of data. So in some cases, it is available. In the PV systems, it's not always available.
OK, thank you.
I hope this answers. Yeah.
We will see you soon here. We hope so. Thank you very much, and goodbye.
Thank you. OK, enjoy. Have a nice day. Bye.